In 1776, the first American patriots armed themselves and fought for freedom from British rule. In 1846, the Army of Mexico tried to take over Texas. They were met by a host of tough Western frontier troops, and Texas remained United States territory. In 1863, the Union forces in blue marched on Vicksburg and engaged the gray-clad Confederate troops in deadly combat to determine the future of the nation. Four years later, in 1867, it was Indian fighting on the Great Western Plains. In 1898, there was trouble with Spain, and our boys found themselves in Cuba at a place called San Juan Hill. By 1917, America could no longer avoid the conflict in Europe, and a year later, U.S. troops were fighting in France. In 1942, something had to be done about Hitler and Tojo. Once again, our men picked up their rifles and fought a global war. Ten years later, the communists were gobbling up South Korea. American intervention put a stop to that. The American infantry soldier. In every war, he is the little guy. But without him, all of the grand strategies to defeat the enemy would fail. He is at once wretched and glorious. When called upon to perform a vital mission, he fulfills his job with intelligence and professional skill. These men, who have carried the rifle through endless months of jungles, rice paddies, and heat, have learned to endure and to triumph in freedom's cause. This is their story, the story of the combat infantry soldier. In Vietnam, the American infantry soldier has one strike against him before he ever gets to the problem of finding and fighting the enemy. It's the land. Aside from the rice farming districts, it's mostly swamp country, jungles, or brushy wilderness. Roads are few and far between. For an infantry soldier constantly on the move, this is bad news. But despite the hardships he has had to face, the U.S. soldier with a rifle has learned to live and fight effectively here. Four companies of combat infantry soldiers occupy a camp in the forward area around Duc Hoa. Saigon is about 15 kilometers to the east. The job here is to locate groups of enemy terrorists who are trafficking through the area and prevent them from infiltrating the city of Saigon. A platoon of men from Alpha Company has just spent the night on ambush patrol. After their dark vigil, all these men can think about is their breakfast. Feeding a hot meal to a company of combat troops in the middle of nowhere is no easy thing. The mess sergeant is all too familiar with the difficulties of the job.
At a Florida area camp like this one, combat troops are given two hot meals a day, breakfast and supper. The food is brought to camp by a truck convoy. For the cooks, it's a pretty rugged schedule. We start the fires about 0200 and must have breakfast ready for the men when they begin their day at 0600. Breakfast usually consists of fruit or tomato juice, bacon and fried eggs, and hot coffee.
After an all-night patrol, the men are given a stand-down. This means that unless some kind of emergency comes along, they will not be asked to hunt the enemy again today. It is a day of rest, and physical comfort is their main concern. Even shaving with cold water is a pleasure after the heat and the flying insects of the night-long patrol. When you set up camp in the middle of raw wilderness, you've got to expect life to be a little basic. If you want comforts, you've got to use your imagination. In this climate, a shower is one of those comforts. And the men of Alpha Company have imagination.
When I write home to my girl or my folks, it sort of makes me feel closer to them. Of course, I've never been much of a writer, but I can usually say pretty much what counts. I'm okay. Don't worry. I love you.
Your rifle is your best friend. If that sounds corny, okay, but it's true. When your life depends on something working right, you just sort of get in the habit of taking care of it. In this country, that means every day. Everything's so damp, if you don't keep your rifle right, it'll rust up while you're looking at it.
A Viet Cong soldier has been captured by an early morning patrol and brought back to camp. Before being transferred to the rear area, he is questioned regarding the whereabouts of his companions and the hiding places they use for weapons and ammunition.
Asking how do they hide in the canal and where do they hide in the canal?
Khi mà bây giờ con ngoài ra đó anh có ngoài ra mục đích anh có làm gì khác không? Đó anh biết có cái anh đi theo dọc cái lỗ nào hoặc là đó anh biết cái những hầm hố gì bây giờ đó anh chắc cá có vũ khí gì giấu đó không?
The defenses of this camp are still being erected. Before the day runs out, these men will fill and use hundreds of sandbags to reinforce bunker positions ringing the camp.
When we're not actually out patrolling, we put in a lot of time digging in better. So you get to be an expert at filling sandbags. It's hard, sweaty work, and it's boring. But it beats sitting around in a mortar barrage and wondering how come the walls didn't hold up.
The sandbag parapets being built are highly effective in stopping mortar fragments and bullets.
Yep.
The outer defenses along the camp perimeter are especially important when it comes to stopping enemy penetration at night.
We don't skimp on the barbed wire. We string this concertina so thick a cat would have trouble getting through. If anything moves in the wire at night, trick players light the whole place up. I don't know about Charlie, but I don't want to be standing in the middle of this wire when the lights go on.
If the enemy were able somehow to get through the field of concertina wire, he would be faced with yet another defensive device, Claymore anti-personnel mines.
These Claymore mines really do a job. They're built in a semicircle and are aimed at the target area with a small sighting device on top. The mines are loaded with C4 plastic explosive and 750 steel balls. When we set these things off, the steel balls go out and stop Charlie from coming in. Of course, we have to fire the mines manually. The detonation wires are strung out from the mines to our hidden positions. The backblast from these babies is really something. Within 50 feet, the flying sticks and stones will knock a man down. So we have to be careful about that. When we lay out several of these claymores in a pattern, they're sure to cover a lot of ground. Anybody getting into the field of fire isn't coming out.
When the work has been completed, a security inspection is made to detect any weak links in the outer defenses.
One thing for sure, if there's a hole in this wire, Charles will find it. So we make sure there's none to find. We're real ingenious that way.
Once While some of the combat riflemen have remained in camp, other soldiers have been sent out on patrol to search for signs of enemy activity in the area.
Recon patrolling is something we do all the time. Most days you just sort of check out some peaceful looking village or another, and then the next time you wind up catching rounds all over the place. Nobody ever knows how today will go, and that's what keeps you from getting careless, you know, zap. I always watch the signs. Usually village life moves pretty slow and easy, so I watch for sudden movement or something that looks out of place.
Open that cabinet.
No outward evidence of the enemy is found. It is noticed, however, that there are no Vietnamese males of military age in the village. The male Viet Cong frequently vacate a village when American troops approach. They leave behind only the women and children. The platoon leader decides to reconnoiter an area of dense underbrush which borders the village to the north. To reach the area, the soldiers must cross open rice paddies. The spot where the undergrowth begins is about 100 yards away. If there are any Viet Cong forces nearby, they will most likely be hidden there.
That particular day, we didn't find anything. 5 straight hours we swept the area and didn't see a thing. Which, when you come right down to it, is okay with me. Then we headed back to camp, 15 clicks, to the boonies, carrying it all back home.
As the day draws to a close, the men at the camp prepare for their hot dinner of ham, mashed potatoes, and cream spinach. Once more, the food trucks have made the long, jouncing ride from the main camp out to the forward base. Now the Mermite cans are lined up in the familiar chow line. When it is over, they will button down for the night.
Charlie hits this compound. He'll do it after dark. But you never know what night he'll pick. So from sunset on every night, we have guys on sentry using the starlight scope.
For the security guards, it will be a long night of watching and listening.
Here we go again. No moon, no stars, no nothing. Just bugs and heat. They have more bugs than they know what to do with in Vietnam. Boy, I hope Charlie doesn't hit us tonight. If they come, they'll probably use mortars like everywhere else.
The only thing that came in the night was another of Vietnam's many rains. And so the day begins for the men of Charlie Company who will remain in camp today.
Think we're going to get this pan hand from you?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know how long it's been getting pretty wet. I cleaned my hands with men in 2 months.
My sweater might be good.
Take all the challenges away. I like the laundromat,
isn't
it? Yeah, we got to do this a little more first. Last time I washed.
Laundry is only one pastime in this camp. There are also outdoor haircuts.
Like that, I'll cut it all off.
I'm not.
We'll try something else on you, Doc.
How many more days you got over here, Doc?
76.
76. And you're going back to Richmond,
Virginia,
going
back to Richmond.
Nice place, man.
Go back and meet my fiancée.
And, of course, there are the usual bull sessions.
I think I'll go down to Hawaii on my second hour. I left my wife down there before. Pretty nice one.
Greg McKee?
Yeah.
What'd you do?
He got
Hogan's older?
Yeah. He was out there. He played one night down there. But right on the beach. He was beautiful.
That type of
girl.
How are the
prices
down there?
You didn't want to go to... Pretty fair. Not bad. You were all right. I think I'll go again.
I want to clean this thing even longer, man.
You want to meet your wife the second time? Yeah, I'm going to meet her down there the second time.
Hang on.
We had a ball the first time, so I'm sure we'll be able to have another ball the second time.
I'd like to know
about
the
great
watch.
It was nice. That was the best part.
Fireball! Fireball!
Next to their dreams of rest and recuperation leave, known simply as R&R, the most important event in the lives of these combat soldiers is the delivery of mail from home. It is a time filled with suspense, joy, and sometimes disappointment when no letter comes.
Whoa, man!
Hey, thanks.
Did you
get a letter today?
Marshal! Campbell! Whoa, man! Shelley!
For the members of Bravo Company, it is a day of hunting and discovery. The men of 1st Platoon discover a network of Viet Cong tunnels.
Decimal 8, right decimal 1, in about a 200 meter radius of this area, we found approximately 30 to 40 fighting positions and tunnel sleeping positions combined. Each position is about the same size as what I told you before.
When tunnels are discovered, they have to be carefully checked out. In some tunnel complexes, the Viet Cong store food and weapons, which must be seized or destroyed in order to curtail enemy activity in the area.
I'd estimate this thing to be about a company-sized element.
The tunnels found today are checked. The only way they can be checked. A soldier goes in.
They call me a tunnel rat. I never know what I'm gonna find down there. It's kind of a scavenger hunt. Only if you find the wrong prize, it can take your head off. I don't know, I guess somebody's got to do it. Today the tunnels are just right, nice and empty. But there's always the next batch.
To help ease the tension and fatigue brought on by the demands of combat, the U.S. Army operates an in-country rest and recuperation center at Vung Tau. Periodically, weary combat soldiers like these from the camp at Duc Hoa Sector get 5 days of R&R here. While closely supervised by officials at the center and restricted by some basic rules for their own benefit, most American fighting men who come here enjoy the facilities and the activities. Upon arrival, they are greeted by a tape-recorded orientation message.
On behalf of the Commanding General, 1st Logistical Command, the officer in charge of the R&R Center and our staff, we welcome you to the Vung Tau In-Country R&R Center. You should have in your possession a DA-31 form stating in the remarks section that you're filling an established R&R allocated quota from your unit. Or you should have special orders indicating that you are authorized on R&R.
Despite government formalities, the men are delighted to be at the center.
Man, it's been months since I even saw a real bed with white sheets. It's like being back in the real world again.
While Army chow in the field is wholesome and satisfying, there is not the luxury of choice to be found here. Salad greens and a variety of meats are a real treat. Any yearning a man may have for ice-cold milk or fresh vegetables can be fulfilled at the R&R Center merely by exercise of the old boarding house reach. Nightly entertainment at the center provides a real change of routine for the weary soldier. At this point in his tour of duty in Vietnam, the soldier is interested in relaxing and entertainment. Plenty of ice-cold refreshments and snacks further lifts his spirits.
Maybe I've been in country too long, but some of these local bands really seem to have the hang of playing our music. Anyway, they come on just as strong, and the beat is in there heavy.
Give me a level piece of ground, and no one shooting at me, and I'll start a ball game every time.